वेलकम फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस फार्मास्यूटिकल सस्पेंशंस। इन टुडे सेशन विल कवर डेफिनेशन, क्लासिफिकेशन, देन एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ सस्पेंशन डोसेज फॉर्म एंड डिफरेंस बिटवीन फ्लोक्युलेटेड एंड डीफ्लोक्युलेटेड सस्पेंशन। Now we'll see a definition of this suspension and what is a dispersed system. The term dispersed system refers to a system in which one substance is distributed in a discrete unit throughout the second substance. And this second substance is known as a continuous phase, means one substance which is dispersed into this continuous phase and whole system is known as the dispersed system. Each phase can exist in solid, liquid and gaseous states. Suspensions are a heterogeneous system consist of two phases. Most probably it is a solid dispersed phase into liquid continuous phase. A solid and liquid dispersion in which particles are colloidal size, and its dispersed system is consist of two component. One is your dispersed medium and second is your dispersed phase. While this dispersed phase is insoluble into the dispersed medium, and dispersed medium is either aqueous liquid or oily liquid. Then we'll see actual definition of pharmaceutical suspension. Is a coarse dispersion in which internal phase is dispersed uniformly throughout the external phase. Since your therapeutic agent is uniformly distributed into the suitable medium, into the suitable dispersed system, and this system or a phase is known as external phase. Internal phase consists of insoluble solids, that is a dispersed phase, having a range size of 0.5 to 5 micron, which is maintained uniformly throughout the suspending vehicle with the aid of single or combination of suspending agents. In case of the external phase or suspending medium is generally aqueous, in some instances it may be organic or oily liquid for non-oral use. For example, azithromycin pediatric oral suspension is there, then ofloxacin oral suspension is there in the market. Then what are the reasons why we have to formulate this suspension? When your drug is insoluble into the delivery vehicle, in that case we can go with pharmaceutical suspension. Then to mask a bitter taste of drug, then also we can go with suspension. To increase drug stability with the help of this suspension dosage form. Then to achieve controlled and sustained drug release from the formulation. So it will be helpful to develop sustained release formulation which will give you therapeutic effect for longer period of time as compared to the conventional form. Example of some pharmaceutical suspensions: antacid oral suspension is there, then antibacterial oral suspensions are there. Then dry powders of oral suspensions. In this type of the dry powders, they are provided with the sterile water. Just you have to mix that dry powder with the sterile water, and then you have to prepare this powder. You have to convert this powder into the suspension form. Most probably, the antibiotics are available into the dry powders, and when vial is given. Or ampoule is given along with this dry powder, so that water just you have to mix with powder and convert it into the suspension. Then analgesic oral suspensions are there, like paracetamol oral suspension is there, then ibupara is there,
Then anthelmintic oral suspension is available into the market, like mebendazole suspension or Mebex suspension. Then anticonvulsant oral suspensions are also available. Then antifungal oral suspensions are there in the market. Now we'll see a classification of this suspensions based on general classes. They are classified into oral suspension and externally applied suspensions. So oral suspension includes paracetamol, then antacid suspensions, and then tetracycline hydrochloride suspensions are there. Then second type, that is externally applied. Just we can apply this suspension externally on the surface of your body. So these type of the suspension like includes calamine lotions. Then parenteral suspensions are also there, like procaine, penicillin G, then insulin, zinc suspensions are there. Based on solid particles, dilute suspensions are there, means how much solid you want to disperse into this dispersed medium. Depending on that, they are classified into dilute suspensions and concentrated suspensions. So if amount of solid is 2 to 10% weight by volume, then it is called dilute suspensions. Example, cortisone acetate, then prednisolone acetate suspensions are there. Then if concentrated suspensions consist of solids up to 50%, like zinc oxide suspension. Then based on electrokinetic nature of solid particles, they are classified into flocculated and deflocculated suspensions. So what are the electrokinetic properties of the dispersed solid, and based on this property the suspension is classified into two subclasses, that is flocculated and deflocculated. Based on solid particles, size of that solid dispersed phase, it is classified into colloidal suspension. A suspension having a particle size of suspended solid less than about 1 micron is known as colloidal suspension. Then if particle size of your suspension dispersed phase is greater than 1 micron, then it is known as coarse suspension. Microbar is an example of this coarse suspension. Then nano suspensions. Nano suspensions are the biophysic colloidal dispersion of nano sized drug particles stabilized by addition of the surfactants. So it reduces surface tension between your nanoparticles and dispersed medium, and drug is equally distributed throughout the system. Size of the drug particle is less than 1 mm. Then advantages of the suspension dosage form. Suspension can improve chemical stability of certain drugs like procaine, penicillin G. Then drug in suspension exhibit high rate of bioavailability than other dosage form. If you see order of or rate of bioavailability, then suspension is at a second position. First is solution, then suspension, then capsule, then compressed tablet, and then coated tablet. This is order for the rate of bioavailability. Duration and onset of action can be controlled by modifying excipients into the suspension dosage form. So we can convert it into the sustained release formulation, like protamine zinc insulin suspension. Then suspension can mask unpleasant tests of your drug, like chloramphenicol. Easy to swallow for pediatric and geriatric patient as compared to the tablet dosage form or capsule dosage form. So if a person is suffering from any swallowing issues, then we can prescribe suspension. Then disadvantages with this suspension dosage form, there might be chances of physical stability, sedimentation and compaction can causes a problems. There might be chances of settling down of that solid particle at the bottom. So there is a cake formation. It is a bulky sufficient. Care must be taken during handling and transport. Then it's difficult to formulate. Then uniform and accurate dose cannot be achieved unless a suspension is packed into the unit dosage form. So during measuring of that formulation or measuring of the suspension, if doctor prescribed you take a 5 ml twice a day, so when you are counting 5 ml, so you should take care of that. So it is not like that you can take one tablet and then you will get a uniform dose. So during taking a dose, you should take care that same drug will be issued for regular interval of time, or same drug should be taken by the patient after regular interval of time. So in case of the tablet, no such issues are there, like dose measurements, just you have to take a tablet and you have to swallow it. But in case of suspension dosage form, there is a need to take or there is a need to measure the dose. In a liquid dosage form, one more disadvantage is microbial attack. Okay, because dispersion medium is aqueous in nature, and in aqueous medium there is a sudden growth of microbial species. Then applications of the suspension dosage form. It is usually applicable in insoluble and poorly soluble drugs like prednisolone suspensions. Then helpful to prevent degradation of drugs or to improve stability of drugs. For example, oxytetracycline suspensions. Then to mask a test of bitter unpleasant drug like chloramphenicol palmitate suspension. A suspension of drug can be formulated for topical application like calamine lotion. Then suspension can formulated for parenteral application to develop controlled rate of drug absorption by parenteral route like penicillin procaine. Then vaccine as an immunizing agent are often formulated as a suspension like a cholera vaccine. Then X-ray contrast agent are also formulated as a suspension like barium sulfate suspension. Most probably it is used into the fluoroscopy. When you are studying physiology of your gastrointestinal tract, then this X-ray contrast media is given to the patient. Then we can study gastrointestinal tract by using this X-ray technique. Then features desired into the formulation of, into the pharmaceutical suspension. It should be easily resuspend. There is no settling of particle when you shake it moderately, then it can be easily redispersed. So uniform distribution of drug is there, and then we can take a dose of that drug. So on label of the suspension, always written one caution that is check well before use. It should be easy to pour, it not watery and not grittiness. It should have a pleasing odor, color and palatability. So you can use different coloring and flavoring agent in this formulation. So elegant color and flavor will be there. No syringeability. It should be physically, chemically and microbiologically stable. There should not be any physical and chemical instability. There should not be any microbial growth. Then parenteral and ophthalmic suspension should be sterilized. When you are using the suspension parenterally or into the ophthalmic cavity, then it should be sterile before, or it should be available in the sterile form. Then we'll see a deflocculated and flocculated suspension. What exactly the difference between these two type of the suspension? Depending upon electrochemical properties of this dispersed phase, the suspension classified into two subclasses, that is flocculated suspension. Now in this flocculated suspension, and in flocculated suspensions formed, flogs will cause increase in sedimentation rate due to increase in size of sedimenting particles. So loose aggregates are formed into these flocculated suspensions. Hence, flocculated suspension sediment more easily. Here, sedimentation depend not only on size of flog but also on porosity of that flog. So this is a structure of your flog. This dispersed phase form a loose aggregates. They are known as flocs. Then, in case of deflocculated suspension, individual particles are settling instead of formation of flock. There is a individual particle as a single entity, but in case of flocculated, group of particle or loose aggregates of a dispersed phase are there, and in a deflocculated, individual particles are settled. So rate of sedimentation is slow, which prevent entrapping of liquid medium, which make it difficult to redisperse by agitation. Means when you compare flocculated and deflocculated suspension, flocculated suspension can be easily redispersed on agitation. This phenomena is called as caking or claying. In deflocculated suspension, larger particles settle fast and smaller remain in supernant liquid, so supernant appears cloudy. But things will be not like that in case of flocculated suspension. In case of flocculated, your supernant is always clear. Now we'll see exact difference between this flocculated and deflocculated suspension. In flocculated, a particle form a loose aggregate and form a network-like structure. And in a non-flocculated, particles exist as a separate entity. Rate of sedimentation is high in flocculated, while it is slow in case of deflocculated suspension. Then sedimentation is rapidly formed in flocculated, and in non-flocculated sedimentation is slowly formed. Then sedimentation is loosely packed and does not form hard cake, because loosely bound particles with high rate settle at the bottom and easily redisperse. But in case of non-flocculated, sediment is very closely packed and hard cake is formed because of the each and every separate entity settle at the bottom. That's why hard cake is formed. Sediment is easy to redisperse in flocculated suspension, and it is difficult to redisperse in non-flocculated suspension. Then suspension is not pleasing in appearance in flocculated, but it is good in appearance for non-flocculated suspensions. Then flocules stick to the side of bottle because they are loose aggregates, and these loose aggregate adhere to the wall of your bottle from inside. But they, in case of non-flocculated, they don't stick to the sides of your bottles, because each and every particle acts as a separate entity. There is no aggregation or loose flock formation. So this is all about suspension. Thank you.